That's how it all started. When I was, when my mother was pregnant with me, my mother say when she was about 7 or 8 months pregnant, I used to move in her stomach every time she'd be around music. And I would get excited in her womb, my mother said. And my father bought me a set of drums when I was 5 years old. Little set of, I had a, yeah, a cymbal, hi-hat. I didn't have no floats, I mean a bass drum, you know? And that's how I got my, start playing drums like that. My third grade school teacher told me, because I'm left-handed, he always said I'm left-handed. He said, Cho, she called me up in front of the class, I was beating on the desk. And I could be the death sound. And what happened, she said, come up here, Cho Connor, you ain't nothing but a class clown. You know, she said, you're talking about you want to be a drummer, you want to probably be digging ditches for the rest of your life, or you probably be working on a garbage truck. And I went and cried, man, I lost all confidence. I lost confidence in myself. I just lost. And in front of my little kids, you know, like the little boys like to show in front of the girl and things like that. What you do is you want to impress the girl. Man, can you imagine that feel, your children in front of the girl, somebody, I wish I could have disappeared. I didn't disappear, and I went on crying. And I told my father pat me on the shoulder. It's a good thing to have a good father. I tell you one thing, pat me on the shoulder, and he said, Cho, your teacher may know about teaching, but you don't know a damn thing about music. He said, keep doing what you're doing. And then, my father also too. I was real skinny because I had brown collars when I was small. Them brothers out there, soul brothers out there playing ball and everything, man, and showing in front of the girl, here I am, peeping behind looking at the guy. And I actually got jealous of those guys, man, because they was big and hucking and playing ball and they had all the girls from looking at them. My daddy said, he said, Cho, let me tell you one thing. He said, if you learn how to play those drums, you'll have more women than you can shake a stick. Well, let me tell you something. My father was black Spanish from Santo Domingo. And my father, you know, but your father tell you something. If you got a good father and a good mother, that's like God's, but you believe that. And so my father told me, say, Charles, you got to be the best drummer in the neighborhood. No, one of the best drummers in the neighborhood. You got to be one of the best drummers in New Orleans. Then you got to be one of the best drummers when you're traveling on the road. And I thought about all that stuff, you know, and I knew I have to create something and be original. If, you know, if you're original like that, they recognize you. If you play like anybody else, you're playing like that, you're a good drummer, you're playing like everybody else. You got to be original, you got to be different. You got to be bold and different and think all kind of different ideas and things like that. Don't play like the next guy. I was a starving, broke musician in Nashville, Tennessee. I was on the street begging for money, so I know about, you know, begging for money, and I was doing bad. And Richard heard me play, and he sent for me the next day, told the guitar player for the come, and he wanted to talk to the drummer, and Wilbur Smith, another guy from New Orleans, because Richard liked that New Orleans type of music. And so I said, where you live? You live at the YMCA. So went to YMCA and everything and talked to Richard. Richard said, I like the way you play. You're from New Orleans. I said, he said, I know you're from New Orleans. Where you play? And so I said, I'm from New Orleans. He said, I want to organize a band called The Upset, the Beulah Richard and The Upset. The Upset was the band. And he said that I want to take you guys back to Macon, Georgia with me and organize the Upset of band. I said, okay. I said, I was only 18 years old. I said, first I got to get permission from my parents. So he called my mother and everything. My mother said, if that boy with that long hair look like a woman? I said, yes, ma'am. I said, well, he gonna be famous one of these days, mama. Just let me go and play and everything like that. And I'll send you some money home every 2 weeks. So my mother said, okay, don't you get involved with drugs and alcohol stuff, which I was an alcoholic from 19 years old about 35. I was alcohol. Didn't have no drugs, nothing like that. Because I knew alcohol wasn't going to put me in jail, though. If I get busted, no, three or four, even those days, they catch you with a roach pot. They put you in jail, I mean, maybe 5 years, especially down south. So with the alcohol and everything. But anyway, Rich said, I want to bring you to the trains. I want to bring you back to Macon, Georgia. And I want you to, I said, what are we going to Macon? What are we going to train station, Macon, Georgia? He said, I want you to hit a train. So I said, okay, the train. But I was doing this before Richard brought me to the train station. That's what attracted him for the hit on me for the travel with them. And so he said, Charles, so the train went to the Macon, Georgia train station on Fifth Street. So the train pulled off. He said, Charles, what kind of beat is that? I said, it was the eight notes. One and two and three, da 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 da. He said, that's the kind of beat I want you to play behind me when we have our first rehearsal day after tomorrow. And I know I have something. What do you like, this beat or the beat I created? That's the shuffle. But the beat I created in 1953, well, I know that beat would work because that beat was contagious. And it stuck in your head, you know, so. Just like Richard tuned on. Good golly, miss her. We're playing at the Howard Theater and Washington, D.C., and we went to a little small radio station in D.C., and we wanted to cut Keep a Knockin'. That was my time to shine. And I brought in the eight notes. Da, 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 da. And no drummers were playing that, and the drummers, I was playing that before we recorded, way before we recorded. But what happened was no drummers were playing that kind of beat. And so what happened, I said, this is my chance to do my thing. So what happened was, Richard said, oh, let's try a four-bar intro on the piano. So he did the piano, the guitar, did this, the bass player. I said, no, let's do a four-bar drum intro, because the name of the thing is Keep on Locking anyway. Let's do a four-bar drum intro. The first four-bar drum on intro on a rock and roll record. So I came up with this, and the engineer in the control room say, we never heard it look like that. I like that, I like it. He said, play it again, Charlie. And that's history about Keep a Knockin'. And a lot of drummers was playing that kind of beat. I mean, he wasn't coming, but a lot of drummers, millions of drummers are playing that kind of beat today, and they don't know where it originated from. Now, you could put an amplifier on an upright bass, but it don't sound rock and roll. You know, so what happened, we got our bass player, and I told the bass player, I said, now watch me, what we're going to do, I want you to be playing the same thing, and he did the same thing, guy named Basie, we got him from Richmond, Virginia, God bless his soul, he died about 3 or 4 years ago, but he started playing too, doom, 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 I said, try to play the melody, doom, 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 good guy, let me, doom, 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 and the guitar was playing the same thing. Chang, 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 chang. And he would hit on the two and four, like I'm hitting on my third, two and four. Chang, 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 exaggerating on the guitar. And then with Richard doing that too, dun, 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 Richard doing on the piano, and man, that sounds beautiful. Chang, 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 chang. And all that sounds good in harmony together, and everything was together, and it sounds good. Oh, yes, yes. You're doing something. see, a lot of drummers say, man, why are you, you're working yourself to death. You use a lot of energy just playing and stuff like that. You know, you shouldn't be doing it. Why don't you do it like this? You know, I don't do it like that, you know? I said, that's my style, and that's the way I feel comfortable playing. Because I never did really want to copy off no one else, which I did. I had idols. I first wanted to play jazz when I was about 14 years old. No money playing jazz. They call it bebop or progressive jazz. And the bebop was that's the way the instrument sounded. Remember James Moody, the alto player? And he was playing that kind of stuff. But we couldn't make no money doing that. Richard was the only one with Jay in the band, but he wanted all of us to look like a bunch of gay guys. Pancake makeup, little ridge, earring, or the guy that wanted to wear earring, and get your hair curled and all that kind of stuff. Because that's the strategy he used to play the white club down south. Because a man looked like little Richard, all that pancake makeup and all that stuff, and his hair all long. Well, you never seen a man like that, especially African America. That was a disgrace. But he said, we're gonna get in there and we're gonna tear the joint. So that's why how we played the white honky tonk club. And the promoters went for it. So they're not gonna mess with our girl. They're a bunch of sisters anyway. So let them play, you know. And Richard said, and you got to remember, my lyrics is not. It's funny, like a comedian. I mean, so Uncle John was bald, he was silent, duck back in the alley. Now, Uncle John and Bald-Head Sally, there was real people around Macon, Georgia. Because Bald-Head Sally was a big, tall African-American woman, and her on Sunday she would put on a wig, but her hair was very short. That was Bald-Head Sally. And there was an Uncle John, you know, and Lucille, those were real people. You know, and Miss Molly, those were real people. Richard put that into the lyrics and everything like that. But those are real, but that's the way we introduce rock and roll down south to the white club. That's the strategy we use. And after a while, and they found out when we met with their women and everything, man, them guys ain't no sisters, man, you better watch them. You know? And so that's what happened there, you know. But it was so different those days, you know. And then for the play down south, different places, for the play rock and roll, that was, they call it the devil music. That was the devil music, you know. But look how big rock and roll is today, you know. And then Richard and Elvis Presley, and honestly, Richard and Elvis Presley, and I love Elvis. I wish we could have played with Elvis back there in those days. Richard and Elvis Presley was the biggest artist, super artists on this planet, on Earth those days. But we couldn't play together. So we used to play, like we come out on the West Coast, white musicians, black musicians play together. And also on when we go overseas, and also like on the West Coast, some parts of the Midwest and everything. We played a place up in, Amarillo, Texas that was, and they locked Richard up for shaking on the bandstand. And they said, we see little, you have to pay $200 fine. They said, you see that guy Elvis Presley come here, we're gonna lock his butt up too, because we don't want no shaking on the bandstand around here. We don't want no devil music, you know. We don't want that kind of music, because you guys are crazy. And say, we ain't worried with you guys too much, because the music gonna be going out, rock and roll will be going out pretty soon anyway, but rock and roll still around. My first professional job was Roy Wood, Professor Longhair. And he had that song I was called I'm Going to Mardi Gras to New Orleans. I want to demonstrate the way that goes and everything. He didn't use cymbals, he used brushes, but I played with my drumsticks, and very soon I would hit my ride cymbal or crash cymbal. He said, dun, 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 dun. We'll be right back. was his beat, you know. Blueberry Hill. I found my thrill. But then again, just like I was doing, I wanted to make it a little more fancy. So pay attention to my hi-hat drums when I'm doing. I found my dream. See the difference? They had the swing. Well, the swing was mostly for a big jazz band, you know. And then they had the shuffle. Now, a lot of guys had a hard time learning the shuffle because the shuffle was kind of tricky. A lot of drummers had a hard time playing the shuffle today. But the shuffle, but I'm going to tell you what I add to the shuffle. The shuffle. But I did this. Watch my snare drum, my sax cymbal. And then they had the quite natural rumba. You play that with an attitude. And then they had the Dixieland, Mardi Gras, Dixieland, Bourbon Street. Oh, let me know when to sing. Oh, when to sing. Marching in. When to sing. Oh, marching in. Oh, in that number. The best one was Little Richard style. That choo-choo train style was, I'm gonna play a couple of bars of slipping and sliding. Slipping. Slipping and sliding. But you can hear that second line beat, that parade type beat too in there. One of the other Little Richard other tune. Rip it up. Well, it's Saturday night and I just got paid. And na 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 na. Try to be original, practice and study, have a lot of patience and stuff like that, and get away from the crowd so you can be recognized. But not only that, learn how to read music, learn the value of the notes, learn how to compose, learn how to engineer, learn how to mix, well, you know, recording stuff, learn all that. You just can't be a drummer now. You got to, man, these guys going to Boston Conservatory and all these, you know, junior school of music and a lot of professional, they're learning everything. But back then, those days, all we have to learn is be a good saxophone player or drummer, whatever, you know? And you got to be original. You got to try your best and get the right connection. Man, there's a lot of great musicians around here. Maybe one of you guys in the audience, when you was young, you played drums or guitar or something, but ain't nobody gonna hear you or hear about you and somebody represent you till you get exposed. There's a lot of great, there's a lot of Beyoncé's out here. There's a lot of, let's go way back, Louis Armstrong, which that's a long time ago. There's a lot of people, you know, I mean, entertainers out here that got the, but they just didn't get the break. You know, and some guys say, oh man, I didn't get no break. I'm just gonna wind up playing on a boat or something like that. I'm gonna do this for a hobby. Well, if you're lazy and you don't have no ambition, do it for a hobby, but you got a chance just like everybody else. And don't hang around people that's negative, that tell you what you can't do and stuff like that. You got to believe in yourself and you got to be bold in your belief. You got to think about things. You got to think about, when I was a little boy, I played the Apollo Theater twice for Little Richard, and one time with Sam Cooke and one time with Little Willie John. And when you imagine, man, you can bring it. This is a powerful thing right here. When you imagine thing, and you dream, daydream, I call it whatever, you can actually bring the future into the present. And you got to feel like, yeah, I can see myself on stage. I didn't know damn well I was going to be playing Apollo Theater and Brooklyn Paramount and all those places and the Howard Theater. I didn't know we could be in movies and stuff like that. But the thing about that, it happened because I was dreaming. I used to be sitting in the backyard like, I always was the weird one, you know, of the family. I was the third child. And I had an older brother and I had a sister, and I was the third one. My parents love it, everything, but I say, I got to get some kind of recognition. I want to be noticed, man. And it probably happened among you guys, too. Yeah, you're the youngest, so they always get the oldest kids the most attention and stuff like that, you know? And the third child is, you don't get too much attention, so you got to create your own attention. And that's why I started beating on my mother pots and pans in the kitchen, my mother gumbo pot. You read about the gumbo pot and the frying pan. And, my mother said, child, don't be, and my daddy is from the Dominican Republic, and he had that little, he wasn't a musician, but he had that reggae thing. And he said, wait a minute. And my daddy came back there in the kitchen. I was born on Dolphin Street in the Frank Ward, surrounded by band and things. And what happened was, he seen me, and he looking, and he started dancing. And I say to him, I said, I got him, you know? And they all thought I had something to offer. I had long hair. My picture was long hair, and I was 3 years old. I used to tap dance for the white tourists on in front of my house on Dolphin Street. And what happened, I had long hair. And the guy told my mother, that little girl, sugar there. And I said, hey, I'm a boy, I ain't no little girl, you know? Well, drum machine is good because they don't lose time. They keep that beat, they don't lose time. Now, a drummer, you could be one of the best drummers in the world, and you're playing for 35 and 40,000 people. And those days, they didn't have monitors by the drum. We played the theater, had one mic hanging over the drum, and you ever hear the echo, boom, you hear, yeah, boom, whoop, whoop. What I did, I would listen to the, I would look at the guy, because we had the first dance group in the upstairs. It was dance, man, it was, you know, and everything. And I look at them for my metronome, for my beat, for the time and everything, you know. But DJs, they have drum, but that's, drum machine don't have no soul, don't have no heart, don't have no blood, no pulse, or nothing like that, you know. I like the real thing, man. Now you can keep on beating up with all your modern stages, because all you got, you know, you got, your sock symbol, mic, your snare drum, right? Everything is mic, and you got a big monitor right there. But I don't like drummers. I did it because I'm a musician, because I teach professional drummers, and I teach beginners, too, if they learn how to play. If they can't learn in 2 or 3 weeks, I say, no, you're not able. Because my son can play a drum. He want to be a drummer like you. Yeah, but the thing about you got to have talent, man. I would like to play basketball like Kobe Bryant. I don't know. I can't play basketball. God gave me the talent to play drums. You know what I mean? And the DJs had these drum machines and all that stuff, or they be playing everything like that. But I don't dig drum machines and synthesizer, nothing. Keep it natural. Keep it funky and juicy. Because Jan Brown said I was the first one to put the funk in the rhythm. And it was 1982, I think. And I appreciate that. Because I put the funk in the rhythm because what I was doing, I was putting that New Orleans beat. That's where it came. All my, I owe all my, my heart and soul to New Orleans. I got the spirit of New Orleans. It all come from there, man. With the gumbo and the gumbo and the filet and the red bean and right and the hot sauce and the, all that kind of stuff. I owe all my stuff to New Orleans. I love New Orleans.